Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. Today I want to chat all about the hormonal acne that I dealt with a few months ago. Some of you might know that I stopped taking the birth control back in March. I did share a little bit about that in my vlogs and my videos around that time. And unfortunately, when I stopped, I got some really, really bad breakouts. They were mostly like under the skin, kind of small bumps, and it caused this really rough texture on my skin that I especially felt like, of course, when I was doing my skincare, when I was washing my face, I remember just like feeling on my cheeks that it was super, super rough and bumpy. It's totally normal to shed a little bit of hair, of course, like when we are brushing our hair or when we wash our hair. But during that time, I noticed that it was a lot more and it was kind of scary. But I did lots of research and I found that this is completely normal when your body is readjusting after stopping the birth control pill. But having your skin break out on top of that is also just very disheartening. Like, it was not a fun time, and I think just emotionally as well, it definitely takes a toll on your body as well. But I'm very happy to say that pretty much 90% of the breakouts that I was dealing with are now gone, and my skin texture is now pretty much back to normal. I do have some acne scars and like a little bit of discoloration that I have left over from the breakouts that I had, but that does not worry me at all because I can do different treatments and things that can correct that over time. But I'm just very, very happy that the actual texture of my skin is back to normal and that I'm not dealing with those consistent breakouts that I was having before. So today I want to share everything that I did to help to clear the acne that I got and just to help me to rebalance my hormones and my body after getting off the birth control pill. I really hope that you guys are going to find this video helpful, and let's get started. The first thing that I want to mention is a book that I read that I would highly, highly recommend. It's called The Period Repair Manual by Laura Bryden. It looks like this. This was so incredibly helpful to me. It taught me so many things about my cycle, about food, supplements. I have highlighted so many parts of this book. Everything I'm going to share in this video is, of course, what worked for me and my experience. But Laura Bryden, she is a professional and she's worked with thousands of women and she's super, super knowledgeable. So I would recommend to read this book. It is called The Period Repair Manual, but it's not only for fixing your period. It has everything to do with your hormones, and of course hormones affect your skin and your hair and your mood. But if you have lost your period or you do have issues with your period, then of course this book is going to be really helpful as well. I do quickly want to mention that I now take my temperature every morning with this thermometer. This is from Femometer, and I have the app as well, so I track my cycle that way now. And your body temperature actually fluctuates during different stages of your cycle, so you can know when you're ovulating and when your period is about to start just based on your temperature. And of course, as you are tracking this, it becomes more and more accurate. But anyway, the first main thing that I want to cover is diet and nutrition. I feel like this was what really, really helped me to balance out my hormones again. The biggest adjustment that I did was starting to eat a lot more healthy fats like avocados, nuts, seeds, wild salmon, and more sources of protein as well, and less high GI scale foods and less sugar in general. And this really helped to lower the insulin in my body and just to lower inflammation as a whole. This is something that I learned a lot about in this book, and she really stresses the importance of having a good balanced diet, which is probably one of the main takeaways that I've gotten from this whole experience, is just really balancing out my diet. And I now eat from all food groups except for dairy. Dairy is not something that I really eat at all, and I've just been used to it because I haven't had dairy for so many years. I still have milks and yogurts and ice creams and things like that, but they're all from plant-based sources like almond milk, coconut milk, rice milk, oat milk, things like that. So I don't feel like I'm missing out at all. And dairy can be very inflammatory, and it does contain a lot of natural hormones, for a little baby cow to grow into a huge cow in the matter of about 6 months. So you can imagine the effect that it has on our own body and on our own hormones. But other than that, I feel like my diet is really balanced and I feel really, really happy eating this way. A typical day of eating for me looks like some veggies and eggs for breakfast in the morning. So for example, some red bell peppers with zucchini and red onion, and then I'll have 2 eggs on top and about half an avocado. And then for lunch, I will either do something like avocado toast with smoked salmon, or I'll do a tuna salad with either some more avocado or some nuts and seeds in there, or sometimes both. And then for dinner, I'll either do like a baked salmon with some roasted veggies and some brown rice or quinoa. I do sometimes even eat organic chicken or turkey if I'm not feeling like salmon, because I eat a lot of salmon. I do love it, but sometimes it can get a bit repetitive. So I like to mix it up from time to time. And I think that's definitely one of the biggest things I've learned the last few months, is listening to my body and honoring what I need. And not feeling like you have to fit into a certain diet or group or label. We're all a little bit biochemically different. We have different digestive systems, different immune systems, different backgrounds and genetics and ways that we were brought up. So I think this is really important to keep in mind. It's about finding what works best for you. I also make sure that I eat enough at each meal so that I'm not snacking and, you know, constantly reaching for things. This is also really helpful for keeping inflammation down and insulin low in your body. And too much insulin is actually a huge contributing factor to acne and breakouts. I will make sure to have some links and resources down below in the description box that talk all about insulin and how it relates to acne and what it does in our body and how to lower it. I'll have those resources below in the description box, and I would highly recommend checking those out. And some foods to avoid when it comes to acne. I'm sure you guys already know this stuff, but I just want to cover it quickly. So of course, too many packaged or overly processed foods are of course not going to be good for you, because they are very inflammatory. Sugar is of course such a huge one when it comes to acne. Again, I'm sure you guys already know this, but sugar can actually be hidden in a lot of different products like yogurts, pasta sauces, ketchup, of course cereals, and even in some like whole foods like dates or honey. I think these things are fine in moderation and in balance. It's important to have a good balance, and again, you have to just know what works for you. Some people prefer to avoid it altogether, and then some people like to have like an 80-20 rule. For me, 80-20 works best, because I do enjoy little things here and there. But when my acne was really, really bad and I was really trying to heal it as quick as possible, I really tried to limit the amount of sugary things that I was having, and it did help a lot. So again, you just have to know what works best for you. And another thing to avoid for acne is of course dairy, which we also talked a little bit about before. And there are so many alternatives to dairy these days that I feel like that is a pretty easy one to, you know, just make a simple switch. So the next important thing that I want to talk about are supplements. If you take anything away from this video, it would firstly be to get this book. And the second thing would be to take zinc supplements. Zinc is incredibly important for the skin, and it's actually been shown that people who do suffer with acne are naturally very low in zinc. And zinc is something that our body actually doesn't store, so it's important to get a fresh source and a fresh supply every day. Zinc is very anti-inflammatory, and it's also very good for skin healing and wound repair, which makes it especially important for acne. Another supplement that I would highly, highly recommend is vitamin A. Vitamin A is actually one of the main components of Accutane, and Accutane is actually a really, really strong medicine that is prescribed for people with severe acne. I was even prescribed Accutane many, many years ago before I learned about all of this stuff. I never ended up taking it because the side effects are actually very, very strong. It can be very toxic for your liver, and there are a lot of other side effects like depression, super dry skin, and it can really take a toll on your emotional well-being. So I never ended up taking that, but the main component of Accutane is vitamin A. So you can actually take the natural and simple form of vitamin A through a vitamin A supplement. Another supplement that I take is cod liver oil, and this actually has some naturally occurring vitamin A in it, but cod liver oil is also an amazing source of omega-6 fatty acids, and omega-6 fatty acids are so important for hormone health. Cod liver oil is also very anti-inflammatory and has been known to be really helpful when it comes to acne and skin health, and even hair health, nail health. Something else that I found really helpful is vitamin D. I have two different like types of supplements that I take. This is a multivitamin from Ritual, which contains vitamin D. So I will either take this, and these ones are prescription. They are a little bit stronger, a bit of a higher dose than these ones. Just depends on the time of year. Of course, vitamin D is something that we naturally get from the sun, but most of us don't actually get the amount of sun exposure that we are supposed to. So it's really, really important to supplement with a vitamin D. I'm actually usually pretty low in my vitamin D, so it is really important for me, especially to supplement. And another one that Laura talks a lot about in the book as well is magnesium. Magnesium can be really helpful in calming stress and calming your nervous system. And of course, stress and your emotional well-being plays a huge role on your hormone health and on your digestion and of course on your skin as well. And then there are a few more hormone-specific kind of balancing supplements that can be really helpful as well. One that I took for a while is called Vitex Extract. This is a pretty well-known one when it comes to balancing hormones. Some other great ones to look into would be evening primrose oil and maca powder as well. DIM is another one that is known to be pretty helpful as well, so I would recommend looking into that one as well. And of course, you don't have to take all of these supplements. These are just a few recommendations that you guys can learn more about and do more research into. Supplements can be really, really helpful, but I think the main thing is definitely addressing diet as a whole, making sure that you're eating a lot of anti-inflammatory foods, good fats, good proteins, and avoiding too many packaged and overly processed foods, sugar, dairy, wheat, because good supplements, again, they're important, but they're not going to be very helpful if we keep putting in the things that are aggravating our body and our hormones. And the last thing that I quickly want to cover is a little bit of skincare. So hormonal acne, of course, stems from the inside. It is the inside that has to be fixed in order for the outside to be clear. So as we're working on the internal things and balancing out our hormones and calming inflammation, reducing insulin, there are still a few things that are important for the external care of your skin. But I would say to be very, very gentle during this time. When my skin started going through all of those changes with the acne and I had all of those bumps, I was just very, very gentle on my skin because I knew that my skin was already so aggravated and sensitive. I was just sticking to a very, very simple skincare routine. I was cleansing. I would either use this Kate Somerville Eradicate Daily Foaming Cleanser. This has 3% sulfur in it, which is very good for helping to clear acne and breakouts, but it is pretty gentle, which I like. Or I would use the IS Clinical Warming Honey Cleanser. Again, just a very nice gentle cleanser that is specifically formulated for more acne-prone skin types. And then I would just follow up with a gentle moisturizer and an SPF. So I was using the Drunk Elephant Proteini Polypeptide Cream and the Elta MD Broad Spectrum SPF 46. And this is specifically designed for more acne-prone skin types. It contains zinc, niacinamide, and it's really, really great. So I would recommend that just a very simple and minimal skincare routine as your skin is healing. And then when my skin started clearing up a little bit and I wasn't as aggravated with active acne, then I could start to gently exfoliate again with our mask. I was not using our mask during the very active acne, but the mask is really great for helping to clear up old acne scars and discoloration and any little like uneven texture that the breakouts left. Plus, of course, it's great for just keeping my skin clear and detoxified and preventing new breakouts from forming. Other helpful treatments that I would highly recommend looking into would be hydrofacials or microneedling. I have been a huge fan of those for many, many years. But again, I would not recommend it if you have very active and aggravated acne. If you are like in the middle of going through all of this, I would just say go very, very gentle and simple and minimal. And then you can work on those things like texture and scarring and discoloration when the acne settles. And above all, I would say it just takes time for your body to heal and to rebalance. I really try to be very, very gentle with myself throughout this process because I know that I voluntarily put my body through this by taking the birth control for so many years, and I definitely didn't want to put so much pressure on my body to just bounce back completely right away. I definitely had to practice a lot of patience and compassion with myself throughout this time, and even though it was really, really frustrating going through all of this and just seeing your skin change so drastically, and also again my hair, it of course was not a fun or enjoyable time, but I am so happy that I went through it and that I'm now on the other side, and I can say that it does get better. Our bodies just definitely need time to rebalance, and if you are dealing with a lot of acne or different symptoms, then just stay calm, get this book, read it, study it. It really helped me so much, so I hope that it's going to do the same for you. Again, I will make sure to have all of these things linked down below in the description box, along with some other good resources and videos that you guys might find helpful as well, so definitely check below. I do quickly want to touch on fungal acne, because this was something that I came across in my research when I was trying to figure out what was going on with my skin, with my body, my hormones. I thought that I had this for a little while, so I did change my products that I was using, but it didn't really help that much. I really saw an improvement in my skin when I addressed more diet-related things, but what I did take away from this is that some oils can definitely aggravate acne. I know that squalene oil does not do that, but I do still use some oils in my skincare routine, and my skin is fine, but it is something that I am more mindful of now that my skin is a little bit more sensitive and reactive to different things. I did want to mention this though, because I know that this is something that can happen from getting off birth control and our gut flora and digestive system changing a little bit, that can definitely cause overgrowth of bacteria in our intestine and also on our skin. If you think this is something that you might have, then maybe look into this further. But yeah, I just wanted to make a little mention of that. I really, really hope that you guys enjoyed this video, and I would love to know your experience if you have dealt with hormonal acne, or if you're thinking of getting off of the birth control pill, or if you've already gotten off of it and what your experience was. Definitely let me know down below in the comments. Thank you so much again for watching. I hope that you're all having a really nice day, and I will see you in my next one. Bye guys.